Karen, you said last night that the Trump campaign had tapped into, quote, underlying cultural anxiety about change that we were not willing to do, meaning the Clinton campaign. What exactly do you mean by that?
Sure. Well, part of a couple of things. I mean, number one, what we talked about yesterday is, you know, Donald Trump made a decision literally from his very first speech of the campaign when he talked about Mexicans being rapists and criminals that really set a tone throughout the campaign that made it, you know, it was scapegoating immigrants, talking about a Muslim registry and shutting down the borders. And just was willing to engage in a kind of language and in a kind of dog whistle politics that seemed to be, you know, I think what we've seen in the past, the goal of which is to stoke people's anxieties, economic anxieties, cultural anxieties. I mean, our country is going through tremendous change. And I think there are, you know, for many that's some that they're afraid of that, and they don't, maybe it's too much change. I mean, there's so much conversation about change, but I think there was also a dynamic in this electorate of some people who didn't like some of the way the country is changing. And, you know, I guess the point we were trying to make there, it's not that the concerns of those voters aren't legitimate and important. We tried to speak to them in a different way by talking about the idea that we're stronger together, by talking about how do we make the economy work for everybody rather than trying to sort of scapegoat people and divide people.
But you talk about voters having, Trump voters having a fear of change. The flip side of that is many voters saw Donald Trump as an agent of change, much more so than Hillary Clinton.
Sure.
And the Clinton campaign was essentially, you know, embracing President Obama's record. And if you really wanted, you know, change in Washington, wasn't Donald Trump, you know, making that argument more than Secretary Clinton was?
But it's, but I guess, so Anderson, what we were speaking to, though, in this part of the conversation, and I mean, so I think there's two pieces to that. There is, yes, I think there's no question that there was a dynamic in the electorate that people just wanted wholesale change, something totally different, no question. And I mean, it's sort of ironic, though, that, you know, people are suggesting that Washington isn't working when we know that, you know, the Tea Party folks who have come to Washington, mostly led in the Republicans, have very, you know, been very adamant about making sure that things are broken in Washington. But so the idea being, sure, that is part of it. Donald Trump represents wholesale change. On the other hand, though, and this is the other piece that we were getting to and that I think is important to understand the dynamics of what happened in this race and what that means for our country. I mean, think about where we were 4-8 years ago when we were talking about the Obama coalition of voters and what his election meant. Here we are 8 years later, part of the coalition of voters that Donald Trump and his campaign put together includes the alt-right. And we know that a big piece of the alt-right, they consider themselves white nationalists, which I personally think is a polite sort of PC way of talking about white supremacists. It includes neo-Confederates. It includes, you know, a range of people who have very specific ideas that are oppose multiculturalism, don't believe that women should be in positions of leadership because, as one has said, it's against the natural order of things, or question if that's the natural order of things. So it's very misogynist. And they are people, you know, some consider some of the comments anti-Semitic. We had, you know, Richard Spencer, one of the leaders of the alt-right movement in Washington just 2 weeks ago, very openly in an open press event say, you know, America is for white people.
And that was one of the things that Kellyanne Conway said, asked you point blank and Jennifer Palmieri yesterday, do you believe Kellyanne Conway provided a platform for white supremacists? And you said yes.
Yes, absolutely. Well, let's look at the facts. Steve Bannon, who is the former CEO and head of Breitbart, which ironically both she and I believe it was David Bossie suggested was a teeny little website that nobody knows anything about, which that's a whole other, you know, they are a huge undergirding of this alt-right movement. Now, Steve Bannon himself suggested that Breitbart is the platform for the alt-right. So, and if you look at some of the, you know, headlines Breitbart, you know, runs, things like birth control makes women unattractive and fat, I believe, is one of them. So, I mean, if you're going to say that that is someone you are willing to bring into your campaign and give a very senior position to, And then now a very senior position in the White House. I mean, this is someone who himself has said that the platform he built is a platform for the alt-right. And as I said, the alt-right has some very disturbing beliefs that I think are very much, and this was the point Jennifer was trying to make, they are not consistent with our values. At least, you know, and we just were not willing in our campaign to, that was not the way we were going to run our campaign. And we were very proud of Hillary that she stood up and called out the alt-right, because I think it's important that we, I mean, just take a look, Anderson, just this week, the Associated Press and the Washington Post have had to reestablish guidelines on how they talk about the alt-right, because as we learn more about who they are and what their beliefs are, and they themselves have said they see Donald Trump as their man in the White House, they themselves have said that the appointment of Jeff Sessions and Steve Bannon represent real progress for them. And so, but there are other pieces to this,
Anderson, but let me just jump in, because, I mean, do you believe Kellyanne Conway, I mean, do you think they sat around in the Trump campaign and said, you know what, well, let's get more white supremacists to vote for Donald Trump? I mean, the number of white supremacists in the United States, I imagine, is, you know, relatively small.
I don't think we know. The Southern Poverty Law Center has some pretty good numbers on that. And look, I don't, you know,
but
again,
you think
the alt-right
this was a conscious effort?
Whole range.
Right, I mean, because that's the point. Alt-right, that there is a range of beliefs in it, and certainly there are those particularly abhorrent beliefs represented as we've reported on.
But here's the thing, Anderson. What I think we saw is, what is the coalition of voters that the Trump campaign put together? What I'm saying is that they were comfortable with part of their coalition of voters, including people who had these kind of views. And
although Donald Trump has said that he rejects that.
Hold on. Well, but he said it once or twice and not with anywhere near the veracity of some of his tweet storms against, for example, Alicia Machado or, some of the others that the Khan family who he's attacked. So we know that when Donald Trump really wants to communicate a message, he can do it a lot more strongly than I think we've seen. But here's the other side of it. I mean, the point is, and then at the same time, you know, Anderson, I mean, that's kind of the double message. And I think it's part of why, you know, we have to not just go by what Donald Trump says, but what he does. So he may have said those things, but then again, at the same time, appointing two people so far who we know are seen as key figures to the alt-right. And so the second point I want to make, though, Anderson, that I think is really important to understand about the alt-right is that, and I think a lot of people are coming to understand this, I mean, again, Breitbart is kind of front and center, but there is a whole network of, and frankly, one of the Trump campaign folks was talking about this yesterday, the way they used Facebook and message boards and online ways to communicate. And one of the things we saw was they very adeptly used the fake news that was coming out to push in through those networks pro-Trump stories, lies about Hillary Clinton, things like she's going to be arrested, she's got something's wrong with her brain. Those things were called out, but I think it's important that we understand and that we recognize we've got to deal with fake news. It is very real, and we've got to understand these networks, because I think it's really damaging to the fabric of our country.
Two things, just moving forward, looking ahead now, the suggestion was made yesterday by someone from the Clinton campaign that Donald Trump does not have a mandate from voters because he didn't win the popular vote. Do you believe, he's been elected president. He's going to be the president. He has the House, the Senate. Do you believe Donald Trump has a mandate?
I believe he has a mandate to serve all Americans. And whereas I know Kellyanne said that, I think what was startling to me in her response about this is they need to understand that those additional two and a half, I suspect that number will grow, Americans in the popular vote who did not vote for him, who have given Hillary such a commanding lead in the popular vote, he's got to be their president too.